That was the wildest funeral I ever went to.
I was there too.
Where the academics began to come and say, well, actually, no, no, no. I don't care whether what the last speaker said was true or not. You just let them say it. I couldn't believe it. I was stunned.
Some strange things do happen at services.
No, it's college professors. Yeah. So they're all about the credit. It's like, today it doesn't matter.
Where are our folk? No one, only one person has asked for. Now, we do the roll call before we do the excuses. You do it before or after?
I do it after.
Yeah, after, which is.
Did you guys get a lot of emails this time?
Yes, Creekside.
I got two, three.
I got a few today.
I got two.
Yeah, it was more today.
I got two.
I got four.
But at about 4 o'clock, I didn't get any, and then I came here.
Okay, there was. I think I looked.
Well, they went to you because you're the big boss.
Well, they are writing to the one who's not going to respond back to them. So I was suggesting me to send them to you.
Well, I had spoken. Well, there he is. I spoke to him a couple of times, and I went and met him. Whoops.
Can't walk in. It's too early.
Yeah, Tom, we had four or five today from folks, and I thought they came to all of us.
So I got one from Mike
Cutway.
Or yesterday.
Yeah, one from him yesterday.
Okay, yeah. The weekend.
I got Mary Elizabeth Hanchu, Victoria Creamer, Tim Fox, Diviana Yamauchi. Now, one just came in a few minutes ago.
I understand
how it works. I do. It's funny because I run an advocacy group that allows people to send those emails. And being on this side, like, they don't work.
Stop.
I understand. But I do prefer when people send their own.
But, you know, it don't work, but it does make a difference.
It does make a difference. I mean, I tell you, because I'm, you know, he was telling me the history on the Sly Circle one just before my time. So I understand the problems. I ask.
Hey.
How are you?
Shoot me away when you need to. Shoot me away when you need to. Yeah. Oh, don't worry about it. We will.
Yeah, we do that too.
Sorry, Mr. Caller.
Good afternoon, and welcome to the Durham Planning Commission. The members of the Durham Planning Commission have been appointed by the City Council and County Board of Commissioners as an advisory board to the elected officials. You should know that the elected officials have the final say on any issue before us tonight. If you wish to speak on an agenda item tonight, please go to the table to my left and sign up to speak. For those of you who wish to speak, please state your name and your address clearly when you come to the podium. Please speak clearly and into the microphone. Each side, those speaking in favor of an item and those speaking in opposition to an item, will have 10 minutes to present for each side. The time will be divided among all wishing to speak. Finally, all motions are stated in the affirmative, so if a motion fails or ties, the recommendation is for a denial. Thank you, and let's have the roll call.
Mr. Alturk?
Present.
Mr. Bryan?
Present.
Mr. Busby?
Present.
Ms. Freeman? Mr. Ghosh? Mr. Gibbs?
Present.
Mr. Harris?
Present.
Mr. Hornbuckle?
Present.
Ms. Hyman?
Present.
Mr. Johnson?
Present.
Mr. Kitchen?
Present.
Mr. Miller?
Present.
Mr. Van? Mr. Whitley?
Commissioner Freeman has arrived, and I do have a request for an excused absence from Commissioner Neil Ghosh.
Second. Madam Chairman, I move that we excuse Mr. Ghosh from tonight's business.
Second.
Motion by Commissioner Miller and second by Commissioner Brine that we excuse Commissioner Neil Ghosh from the meeting. All in favor of this motion, let it be known by the usual sign of aye.
Aye.
All opposed? And let's see,
I think
we do have a quorum, so we're ready to proceed. It looks like it as they come in. Yeah. Okay, our first item, are there any adjustments to the agenda? Recognizing Commissioner Harris.
Madam Chair, I would like to add under new business discussion on the training budget.
Okay, any other adjustments to the agenda? Then we'll proceed by adding one item under new business, the training budget. The next item we have is approval of minutes for October 11.
Madam Chair, I move we approve the agenda as modified.
Second.
Commissioner Harris, motion that we approve the agenda as modified. Second by Commissioner Busby. All in favor of this motion, let it be known by the usual sign of aye.
Aye.
All opposed? I think we're ready to open the first public hearing.
Minutes.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Madam Chairman, I have a question about the minutes.
Okay, a question about the minutes.
So, Susan, are the... You and I had traded emails about the completeness of the comment section. The minutes we'll be voting on tonight will be those that with the complete comments, even though they're not exactly like the ones that were mailed to us.
Yes.
Under those circumstances, I move that we approve the minutes.
With the consistency.
Commissioner Brine.
Commissioner Miller, could you modify your motion to include consistency statements?
I was just doing the minutes, not the consistency statements.
Okay.
We could do two votes or one.
Please.
So I will be happy to modify the motion to include the consistency statements.
Second.
We have a motion by Commissioner Miller to modify the minutes, including the consistency statements, a second by Commissioner Brine. All in favor of this motion, let it be known by raising your right hand. All opposed? We've approved the minutes then. Thank you. Now we are ready to open the first public hearing. Case number Creekside Z1600001. We're ready for a staff report.
Good evening, Kyle Taylor with the Planning Department. I can affirm that all legal notices requirements have been executed in accordance with state and local law, and affidavits for such are on file in the Planning Department for all cases being heard tonight. This is case Z1600001, Creekside Commons. The applicant is Stephen Freeman. The jurisdiction is in the city. The request is from Residential Suburban 20 to PDR 6.302. The acreage is 26.821 acres, and the proposal is for 169 townhomes. Just as a note, this was a case that was heard on 9/12/16. And is continued to this meeting. The site is comprised of three parcels located at 5300, 5308, and 5336 Ephesus Church Road. The project is located in the suburban tier and is located within the MTC I-40 and FJB Watershed Overlay Protection District. The site satisfies the criteria for the PDR zoning district, as outlined in this slide and in the staff report. The site is currently heavily wooded and vacant, with the exception of 5308 Ephesus Church Road, where an unoccupied home is currently located. This project meets the requirements for a development plan for the PDR zoning district. The proposed conditions page commits to 5 site access points, location of building and parking envelope, stream buffers, and general location of tree protection areas. Minimum commitments of the site are 169 residential units, 5 external site access points, impervious surface maximum of 30% or 8.05 acres, tree coverage 20% or 5.44 acres. The graphically commits to the location of tree preservation areas and stream buffers, location of access points, and building and parking envelope. There's a number of commitments on this project, including road improvements, dedication of additional right-of-way, and for a major transportation plan, providing sidewalk approval subject to approval of the owner, and crosswalks and other road improvements. They're outlined in this slide and also in the staff report. There are design commitments proffered with this project. All buildings will have a maximum of 3 stories, 2-car garages, and will utilize elements as provided below. They're outlined in this slide and also in the staff report again. This request is consistent with the future land use map, which designates this area as low medium density residential. The staff has determined that the proposal is consistent with the comprehensive plan and policies as outlined in this slide. And as such, staff determines that this request is consistent with the comprehensive plan and applicable policies and ordinances. Thank you, and staff is available for any questions.
I have 2 individuals who have signed up to speak for the project. The first individual is Ken Spaulding.
Good afternoon, members of the Planning Commission, Madam Chairlady, and members of the Commission. My name is Ken Spaulding. I represent the applicant in this matter. The applicant reviewed available and buildable land in Durham for an opportunity for a quality townhome residential development. There was a review of the City-County Comprehensive Land Use Plan for a recommended location for townhomes in Durham. This property and location were recommended by the Land Use Plan of Durham, which had been approved by both the city and county governments, along with Durham residents and neighborhoods during years of preparation of Durham's comprehensive plan. Staff corroborated that 4 to 8 units an acre is recommended for this location. The developer received this guidance from staff, and we are here tonight after many months of hard work, expenditures, and meetings with existing neighbors. Every ordinance, policy, and plan of the City of Durham has been adhered to by this developer. I want to point out that schools are under capacity, as well as Ephesus Church Road. We are dedicating right-of-way for the much-needed southwest Durham Parkway, which will assist in the lessening of traffic on Farrington Road. The townhomes will be significantly separated by this major proposed parkway and city-enforced stream buffer protection from the nearest existing neighborhood. Basically, our project is bifurcated from the existing residence. Mr. Sanziel will provide for you for a more detailed presentation of our plan.
I get it. Good evening. My name is George Stanziel with Stuart, 115 Cofield Circle, Durham. After appearing here at our last meeting almost 2 months ago, we immediately met with the neighbors again. It was a very cordial and educational meeting where we presented a number of maps to try to give the neighbors a larger perspective on, you know, where this site sat within the comprehensive plan relative to transit planning, roadway planning, and the such. So we wanted to give them a bigger understanding of where this site was located. I wanted to summarize just a few things that we feel are especially important in your decision this evening. Number one is density. As you know, our proposed density is 6.302 units per acre, which falls directly in the middle of the densities required by the comprehensive plan at 4 to 8 units per acre. The comp plan was developed, as Mr. Spaulding pointed out, in 2005 with significant community input, and we believe that a townhome community in this location is a perfect fit. Now, we can argue density, which we tend to do, and you know, and whether it's 5, 6, 7 units per acre, you know, we all have our feelings about that. But at the end of the day, the use remains a multifamily use. I am concerned when we argue solely about density because it's a number that is directly a direct relationship of the size of the site, and therefore not always an indicator of the actual intensity of the site or the buildings. For example, if our site were 2 acres larger, which would be about 14 feet larger in around our perimeter, with the same number of units, the density would be 5.8 units an acre rather than 6.3 units an acre. And the project would have the same unit type, building mass, design, and look, and would generate the same traffic and the same school children. The question here is use, and the comp plan calls for a low to medium multifamily use. Our site is encumbered by a 200-foot buffer that you see there on your screen on the left. That is about 5.3 acres and about 200, it is 200 feet wide. It's a 200-foot buffer, stream buffer, which serves to separate our townhomes from the adjacent neighborhood. And the requirement, and we have the requirement to dedicate 110-foot right-of-way for the proposed parkway, which is about 1.8 acres, that bifurcates the site, leaving a developable area of about 19.8 acres. And you can see the right-of-way there in gray, which extends to the east of our site, and then will extend to the south of our site. A single family development adjacent to a parkway, without it being in a planned community such as Woodcroft, for instance, where you have the ability to provide adequate buffers adjacent to roadways, is just simply not feasible in this marketplace, and would create essentially a failed community, or would suggest potentially a lower cost housing type that would ultimately impact value of existing homes. The site is less than a mile in two directions. I'm gonna see how this works here. Yeah, I wanted to also point, let me just back up and point out, this is the land use map, and you see that our site is in the 4 to 8 units per acre area. to the directly to the east, 6 to 12 units per acre. Directly to the south of that, 4 to 8 units per acre, and then commercial and office directly to the east of that. So this isn't an area that is transitioning from single family to multifamily to commercial and office. So the transit, this site is, as I said, within less than a mile, within the transit, a couple of different transit stations. And you'll see here about, 0.86 miles from the Gateway Station and about 0.87 miles from the Lee Village Station to the south. Density is a major factor in ridership and in success of ridership for transit. And also the ability to secure federal funding for transit. So 6 units per acre, as we're proposing, is not even considered reasonable density in a transit area. The second is housing typology. Mixing housing types in close proximity offers lifestyle choices. Durham has been stagnant in that regard, predominantly offering larger lots, single-family communities that are either not affordable nor necessarily fit today's lifestyle. Today we have either aging families who prefer to downsize and have a smaller unit with an HOA maintenance, or young professionals who have other priorities in their lives than a home and a yard. Providing housing choice in residential areas is a positive and creates a more sustainable economic and social model. From a traffic standpoint, we can all agree that there are some short-term traffic issues in the area, predominantly morning and afternoon school drop-off and pickup. Townhomes on this site will have little to no impact on that traffic. Roadway capacity is available on both roads, Farrington and Emphasis Church roads, and improvements are being planned and are approved on both these roads by other developers that will allow more efficient traffic flow. If we were to develop our site, for example, at 4 units per acre, which would be about 104 single-family units, as some have suggested, we would generate as much or slightly more traffic than our current proposal of 169 townhomes and more school-aged children. I ask that you consider these as you make your decision tonight and would respectfully consider approving this case. We have a high-quality national home builder who will provide a very high-quality product for this area. Thank you very much.
Thank you. I do have 3 individuals who have signed up to speak in this order. Number 1 will be Adam Jewelry. Okay. Adam Jewelry. Go ahead.
Good evening. Thank you for having the community here. My name is Adam Jury. I live in Weston Downs, which is directly adjacent to this Creekside Commons property. I would like to identify the members of the audience who are against this development in its current form. Could you please stand? Okay, thank you. So as he just mentioned, our primary concern with this development is the density in proximity with the lower density single family homes around the development. So the rationale is that it would triple the density of the existing communities right adjacent to it, and that is actually not in accordance to the Unified Development Ordinance or the overall Durham planning document. So we would propose a lower unit per acre of no more than 5 units. And this is, we believe, a fair compromise is about 20% less units per acre. And although we understand that there will be traffic issues no matter which way we go, with a single family development or a townhome development, that's still 20% less traffic on an already extremely crowded avenues that come north and south through Durham and also east and west in that area. We have some photos of the traffic of the daily commute that we'll go through in just a minute. Average time going through the stoplight on 54, where Farrington intersects 54 in the morning time, is between 20 and 30 minutes, with about a 5-light cycle change. So it's a very long time to get through those lights in the morning time. Our second, as you can see here, we've seen the maps already, but this is the land in its current form. And you can see that all the developments around this area are single family home, and Durham really promotes continuity with the surrounding communities and developments. And so putting a development of townhomes directly across from an elementary school in the middle of several single family home communities would be directly opposing a lot of those Durham ordinances. So that was one of our main issues with this development.
Would someone like to defer some additional time? Because I had basically allocated 3 minutes for each individual, 10 minutes all total. So how do we want to, are all of you together? Thank you, Mr. Gallagher. I do have your name listed. And Mr. Drury, you can proceed.
Okay, I'll speed up a little bit.
Okay.
So the second point was school overcrowding. So currently the Creekside capacity is about 764 students, which is per the Lee Village 2012 study, which is available on the Durham website. And currently the enrollment is at 960 students, I think, this year. And we have fourth and fifth graders in temporary trailers behind the school, and it's been that way already for about 4 years. If you look at the very bottom here, I think it's a very important point. Mobile classrooms cannot match the quality of educational environment that can be established in permanent buildings. I think that's very important because there is currently no plan to put any additional capacity into the elementary school system in Durham at this point in time. So adding additional students into Creekside, which is exactly where all these kids will go at this point in time, will be very detrimental to their learning process. And in addition, policy 11.1.1b of the Durham plan recommends the denial of zoning map changes when capacity is over 110% in a school. Although I understand that that's sometimes also evaluated on a system-wide level, but this school is already far beyond capacity, and putting another development right across the street would be very unwise. And I think also the community here would agree that nobody wants to overcrowd the schools more than it already is. And then Ted, would you like to come talk about traffic?
Our next speaker is Mr. Ted Szczesinski.
Thank you. Ted Szczesinski, 5314 Weston Downs Drive and Weston Downs Subdivision. Traffic has been mentioned, and I kind of want to bring that to your attention and show you some of the problems we're currently having. Students from Creekside seem to be coming mostly from the south, and their avenue of approach is up Farrington Road, making a left turn onto Ephesus Church, and then another left turn into the holding area for the school. So let me begin by showing you a picture of some of the northbound traffic on Farrington. It's just this is an area map showing the position. It's A, looking northbound. And you can see it's backed up extensively. The same place, just a little farther south, and it's still backed up. So the backup goes a substantial distance on Farrington approaching Ephesus Church. Now, if we look the other direction, a going home scenario, similar situation. These are cars on this is Farrington northbound. Yeah, approaching Ephesus Church. Okay, now we have Farrington southbound approaching 54. Northbound. This is Farrington coming down towards 54. 54 is right in the foreground. A substantial amount of these cars are coming from the school after drop-offs. There's also people just trying to get to work, making a left turn on 54, getting over to the interstate. This is the Ephesus Church School, their driveway to the south. And the proposed subdivision entrance will be directly opposite their driveway. Here are cars backed up on Ephesus Church, waiting to get into Ephesus Church, and of course some of them leaving. And we'll look in the other direction. This is on Ephesus approaching the left turn to get into Creekside Elementary School. And that's what I have.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Are there any additional individuals who would like to speak? So Mr. Gordon Galloway.
Did he give up all of his time?
2 minutes.
Okay.
Good evening to the council and the public, and thank you for welcoming to the meeting tonight. I am much less prepared. I come with my words only. Again, my name is Gordon Galloway, address 114 Baccalaureate Boulevard. I am one of those families coming from the south, heading towards Creekside. And first, I'd like to say that I recognize the need for economic development, and I respect that by all means. I also have been convinced tonight, in my first meeting here, that the planned project has met the grand scheme proposals. I would simply like to question this site for this project being adjacent to Creekside Elementary. I have a 7-year-old daughter enrolled in first grade. I have a 2-year-old son who will be there in a few years. And I'm concerned about the strain that this project puts on the public resources, with particular respect to traffic. As we just saw, I'm surprised you didn't get my car in one of those photos. Safety with the young children attending elementary school and an increase in what is already, for lack of a better word, some ridiculous traffic at particular hours of the day. And finally, the only time I found myself kind of laughing to myself was with this notion that this school is under capacity. Creekside is a fantastic school. We love our teachers, the kids are great, the programs are fantastic. But as we've heard tonight, we have students in trailers, we have very crowded hallways, we have large number of students in small classrooms. I'm also a teacher with Durham Public Schools, and I recognize the very important need for teacher-student ratio. Thank you for allowing me some time.
Thank you. I have no other individuals who have signed up Yes, okay. If you will, I'll need to have your signature on this sheet when you're... There you go.
Hello, my name is Jay Goldstein, 304 Kinsale Drive in Chapel Hill. So I live adjacent in Blenheim Woods, which is kind of running down George King Road on the side of Creekside. So what I would add, I agree, I'm not in support of the development. I think it's going to just add to the overcrowding. I feel like this is really just sort of development ahead of light rail or development ahead of coming larger development. And I just... There have been a number of projects that have come through and then kind of make it past the Planning Commission on the City Council and get approved despite whatever y'all recommend. I just feel like we're adding to a problem to justify light rail or light rail ridership ahead of it actually being funded or really finally approved. It's also years in advance. I believe while the roads have been set to be developed and fix the Farrington 54 issue, that's years away as well. Even though it's in the plan, it's kind of deep in the things to get done. And we're sort of planning or building ahead, which is just adding or exacerbating the problem when the solution is years away and we're sort of building to create or add to a problem that will then be solved by light rail. So I just don't think that makes sense. I would just contribute, I don't have pictures, but the spillover, the traffic is so bad to get into Creekside that many people currently are pulling into George King and parking on that road. So that's another issue that's only going to have to be resolved as George King gets developed, because currently they already don't fit in terms of getting into the school. So they're kind of creating their own solution, which is creating its own safety issues over time. So I would just contribute that's an additional issue related to the school. And then overall safety. So people are crossing the street from the community west end, but they're also coming from my neighborhood in Blenheim Woods. They're walking to and from school, and the traffic is excessive. So I'm one of the lucky ones who leaves the house well before, but they actually switched the time when Creekside started to school, and I got a little more exposure to it, and it stinks. So I would just say, like, while we're planning to solve a problem, and that solution is years away, and you're actually just exacerbating the issue where it's really going to become a deterrent in terms of people who want to live in the area. So that's it.
Thank you, Mr. Jay Goldstein. I do not have any other individuals who have signed up to speak, so I am going to close the public hearing and give our commissioners an opportunity to make comments and ask questions. Do I have commissioners who would like to speak? Okay, Mr. Bryant. Okay, Mr. Gibbs. You want me to make you last?
No.
Okay, we'll start with Commissioner Al Turk.
Thank you, Chairwoman. I have a clarifying question for staff and then a comment. The question for staff is about school impacts. We heard that Creekside has over 900 students, and in the staff report we get, in table G5 we get numbers, but these are system-wide numbers, so we can't assess whether the elementary school is above capacity from these numbers. Do you have numbers just for Creekside Elementary, or is that something we can get?
Sarah Young with the Planning Department. It is our understanding, and we've been advised by Durham Public Schools, that we should only be using system-wide numbers because Durham Public Schools has a policy where they can reassign, districts can shift, there's magnet options, so not every child that necessarily is within a certain area will necessarily go to that school. For that reason, we've been assigned, advised to give you system numbers because there is no direct way to attribute specifically how many kids in that area will actually generate kids that go to that actual school.
Okay, thank you. I guess, you know, my comment is that I'm generally not opposed to density or townhomes, even if they are close to single family homes, and I was inclined to vote for this because I do think in a growing city like Durham, we do need density. At the same time, I think that it seems to me like since the last meeting, the neighbors have compromised, or it seems like they have backed off. I think the initial suggestion was that only single family homes were wanted, and now the neighbors have suggested and given a recommendation of 5 acres per unit, and I think that seems to me like a reasonable suggestion to the developer. I mean, if you look, I think to the point of the first speaker that spoke against the application, if you look at the surrounding neighborhoods, even if you exclude the RS designations, the PDR is the plan development developments around this proposed site are all less than 4 acres per unit. Even to the northeast, you have one close to 4 units per acre. Even to the southeast, you have one at 4.5. And so I do think I would be inclined to vote for this if the developer would go down on the density. I think this seems to me like this is the major sticking point, and it would alleviate some of the traffic and school issues. It seems to me like 6 is maybe a little too high. So thanks.
Thank you. Commissioner Bryan.
Thank you. I also have concerns about the density. I think the 6.302 is too high. I think the neighborhood has made a very reasonable suggestion of 5. I would even like to see it lower than that, but if they can live with 5, then that would be fine with me. I don't really think, even though it's close to 2 transit stations, that this development does much to really support transit. In your development plan, there's commitments to 2-car garages. There's commitments to putting speed humps on your internal roads. This suggests to me that the major mode of transportation in this development is going to be motor vehicle. That doesn't support transit. I'm concerned about the traffic problems. If you come down in density, you will reduce the traffic somewhat, but I'm very concerned about the traffic in front of the school. I'm afraid that people who might live in this development might choose to go out by way of Baker's Mill Road to the north, which will cause problems for them, for anybody who lives along Baker's Mill. I also wanted to note that the Southwest Durham Drive or Parkway is on the MTP plan for 2040. My understanding is that means it hopefully will be built by 2040. That depends on acquiring right-of-way, getting funding, and so forth. The point I want to make is that if this development was approved, it would probably be built out maybe 2 decades before the parkway came along to help relieve the traffic, and that's not good. And the final thing that concerns me, if I may finish my statement, is no bike lanes. That's really bothersome. If you look from Farrington Road to the Weston Downs Parkway, you have the biggest frontage. And you have it in front of a school where there's a lot of congestion and traffic. I think that's one place where a bike rider would really welcome a bike lane. And if you're not going to put a bike lane in, then when other parcels get developed closer to Farrington, they will probably get away with putting bike lanes in. and it defeats the whole purpose of having bike lanes along Ephesus Church Road. So I'd really like to see a bike lane. Thank you.
Thank you. Commissioner Miller.
Thank you, Madam Chairman. I would like to begin with a question for the developer, if I may. Your development plan shows five external access points, one to Ephesus Road, one to Baker's Mill Road, and then there are three others that go to adjacent parcels. You don't currently have any arrangement with the owners of those parcels to build roads or anything.
No.
These would just be stubs.
That's
that somebody
correct.
In the future may or may not connect to, depending upon what the rules might be at the time.
That's correct.
Thank you. And then I also have a question for the, I guess it's for Mr. Szczesinski, who showed us the photographs of the traffic, the school-related traffic. If you could come to the mic, sir, please. You showed us a bunch of photographs, and you may have said so, but if you did, I missed it, rustling my papers. The conditions that you showed us, was that some extraordinary day or school event, or is that every day?
That was a typical school day.
That's every day that school's in session?
Yes, sir.
And it were those just in the morning, is it, or in the afternoon, is it different?
I believe most of them were in the morning. I didn't take all of the pictures. Do you know, Adam? All in the morning, sir.
And so what's what are the traffic conditions like in the afternoon when it's pickup time? But that's occurring sometime around between 2 and 4, I suppose, and not 5 to 7. All right. Is it pretty much cleared out by 5 o'clock? No, it's still going. All right. Thank you. Those were my questions. If I may, Madam Chairman, I would like to make some comments on this property. The future land use map does designate this property as being 4 to 8 units per acre. That doesn't, to my mind, doesn't mean that anything between that is okay or that any density offered below 8 is okay. I believe we have to take the future land use map and interpret what's appropriate for a particular parcel in terms of the written policies in the comprehensive plan. And policy 4.3.2A basically says that we're to encourage and promote compatible residential and non-residential infill on vacant or underutilized property within developed portions of the community to reinforce existing character. And so I'm persuaded by what Mr. Al Turk said in looking at what the existing character is in this area to find a unit density between 4 and 8 that's appropriate and promotes compatible residential infill for this project. And I believe, as Mr. Al Turk said, is the proposed 6+ units per acre is too much given the pattern that's already established in the area. So I think the comprehensive plan requires us to look at this parcel, decide what number between 4 and 8 is correct. 6 is too high, given that all the surrounding areas are developed at a substantially lower unit count. Thank you, Madam Chairman.
Thank you. Mr. Gibbs, Commissioner Gibbs.
Just a couple of comments. This is something that we go through with every development. Traffic, impact on schools, impact on infrastructure everywhere. I didn't have that much objection to 6 units density until I totaled up, that would be what about, compared to the 5 that you're asking for, there would be, 28 more units. How it's going to be fit on this property, I don't know, but I really don't have that much of an objection to the density. The impact on the school, there's nothing we can do about the traffic, number one. And we can't have a moratorium on all development everywhere until all the traffic and all the other concerns are worked out. This is in a proximity to the Lehigh Village and the transit stop there. It will be on the path of the transit, and I agree with the last speaker. It seems to me that we're basing everything on what we hope to have, but let's face it, that's all we've got now. We've got to have some rhyme or reason to our development, and I don't think this development is to support transit. Transit is supposed to work with development. But as far as the school is concerned, if, and this is not going to help traffic going into school, but any students living in this development, it sort of goes with compact neighborhoods. It's walkable. They can walk across the street, which brings up some kind of dedicated crosswalk there for direct access to the school, even some traffic lights, and maybe even some kind of traffic monitor. Maybe some sheriffs or police. I don't know which county it would come from. I would imagine from Durham County. But that could help the safety in crossing the street. And I know I'm going on about a lot of things, but there are just so many things that we have to consider. And right now, I think I would vote for this this development. But let's hear what the owner and what you all can work out as far as coming to some terms. Those are just some ideas I have. Thank you, Madam Chair.
Yes, Commissioner Kitchen.
Yes, my daughter is a fifth grader at Creekside, so I've been doing this for 6 years. And this morning, I don't know if anyone saw this morning, but there was a 40 was backed up, and so no cars could get off of Farrington onto 54 onto 40, and the traffic was backed up almost from 54 down to Ephesus Church Road. I mean, it was the worst I've ever seen just this morning. My point is, I don't know that anything that we do tonight is going to fix that. You know, we've got some real problems with Farrington Road. I didn't know that 2040 was the time for the parkway. But we've got some real problems with Farrington Road, with 54. I mean, it is an absolute disaster. I've done it. This is my sixth straight year doing it. And my daughter's in one of the trailers at Creekside as well. Having said that, I do think we need to face the fact that it's going to be developed. And if we can figure out a way to make less density project work on that site, it will not solve any of our problems with traffic with the trailers, but it will, I think, bring more cooperation with the neighborhood. So I would say that it's going to be developed, and it's a good site. Farrington Road is a disaster. 54 is an absolute disaster. It's not going to get better or worse depending on what happens here. But I would say that maybe if we could find a way to get to a less dense project, as I think Commissioner George said earlier, maybe 5 units per acre might be more plausible.
Thank you. Commissioner Busby.
Great, thank you, Madam Chair. I just wanted to quickly weigh in as well. It was useful to hear the conversation and the questions. It's rare to have neighbors come with a very specific proposal when they oppose a proposal here at the Planning Commission. Normally folks say, I'd like less density. What I heard tonight is a very clear proposal, which I think is incredibly helpful, and the neighbors, you should all be commended for that. And as others up here have said, you could have asked for less, but I think it's a very reasonable request. I have a lot of concerns about the traffic, particularly around the school. The traffic study in our packet is useful but doesn't tell us the story about the very acute issues. So I'm very concerned about the safety around the school as well, and I know that's true in a lot of schools with drop-offs in the morning, with people walking, even having a police officer out doing the crosswalk. It still is very dangerous, and when people are stressed and they're backed up, people make bad decisions. So I'm very concerned about that issue, and so I plan to vote against this proposal. I think it'd be very useful to have additional conversations to take a look at this notion of 5 units per acre. That strikes me as a good compromise, and I think it's something that I hope will continue as this moves forward to City Council. So thank you.
Do I have other commissioners who would like to speak? Commissioner Johnson.
Thank you, Madam Chairwoman. So I have one question for Mr. Stanziel. So I'm reading comments that you provided, and you state that the neighborhood that we have illustrated to the neighborhood that lower density single family development adjacent to this parkway is simply not practical. I was wondering if you could provide more insight into the impractical reality that you state.
I mean, it's very difficult from and you know, this is coming purely from a developer's perspective, but it's very difficult to sell housing in general next to a parkway, a major parkway. Now, again, I know this is something that's very far in the future, but nonetheless, we're being asked to give up land. The city's not buying it. We have to give it up. We have to dedicate it, and it'll be there for the next 20 years or whatever that we talked about, Mr. Bryan brought up. But nonetheless, somebody is going to look when they go to buy a home, and they're going to see a dedicated right-of-way there, and they're going to wonder what's going to be there. And they're not going to care whether it's a year from now or 10 years from now or 20 years from now. They're going to be backing up to a parkway. So it has a major impact on the saleability of homes. Now, it has less impact on the sale of a townhome versus a single-family home. We just know that, statistically. So that was the point I was trying to make, is that, you know, when a parkway or a roadway or this is 110 feet. This is not a typical residential road is, a 60-foot right-of-way. This is 110 feet. So it will have an impact on the sale of homes adjacent to it.
Thank you. And so, and just following up, so I pondered on this particular application for some days now. And so given the feedback that you just provided, it seems clear that finding a way, if you're going to do townhomes, to make it work with the neighboring communities, it just makes sense, as in the options are restricted in regards to the type of product you're going to put on the property. On the flip side, it seems like it's almost like it could be seen as a catch-22 in the sense that if you lower the density, and so I'm a real estate finance type person, so I understand the economics from the developer standpoint, you're probably talking different price points now. So that's a question of who will have access to the housing that will be developed on that property. And I did look at the numbers on the pricing of the houses. If it's anywhere in those ranges or above that, that's just a segment of Durhamites that it's not going to be able to even consider that as an option. And so that's just something to consider. However, when I did look at the future land use map, I saw it was 4 to 8, you know, and I was like, you know, that's what they say it can happen there, but that's not necessarily what should happen there when I'm looking at the surrounding communities and just the density of those communities. And so I wrestled with it, but 6 units per acre was just seemed a bit much. And I wrote that area 2 or 3 times just to get a feel for it. And so that brings me back to, I'm not comfortable voting for the project and the plan as is, but it seems that if the townhomes seems to be the product that makes sense right now, then there should be some effort. I would, you know, implore you to find a way to work with the community, so the surrounding communities, to make this project viable as well as economically feasible for the developer.
Thank you, Commissioner Johnson. Commissioner Hornbuckle.
Thank you, Madam Chairman. This is always a difficult decision with us, especially on a density issue. I really don't think the density issue is going to have the impact on the schools. And I know I'm probably going to get criticized or ridiculed for this, but I'm retired law enforcement. In Bahama, there's traffic problems around Mangum School on Quail Roost Road. And I think a lot of the problem is so many parents feel they're better off trying to drop their children off instead of utilizing the bus system. That it creates quite a problem around many of the schools, and that if more parents would utilize the bus system and transportation with the school system, that would cut down on the problems of, as you stated, the parking on George King or just trying to get in and around the school. But it's virtually at any elementary school or schools in Durham general that we have that problem. I think they have made some concessions on the density, and I'm in support of the project. Thank you, Madam.
Thank you. Commissioner Freeman.
Thank you. Just a few points. I first have to say that I wouldn't blame the parents in this situation. I think that there's a bigger issue in that we don't have a street grid to support the density that needs to be in this area or that could be in this area. And so I just want to make sure I do say that. Similar to Commissioner Johnson, am concerned about reducing the density, but I also am also more concerned about the traffic impact for the school. And I'm not sure that even at 5 that would help, but if that's where your neighbors or the residents in the community are, I would also strongly implore you to see if there was a way to come to some type of resolution around that. I mean, there are alternate, if there were 5 in certain areas or in the, further back there were more, there are different ways to do it. And I think that you might want to spend some time on that. I can't support it in the way that it is right now, but I really would like to. I think that you've done a lot in making those tax commitments, and it sounds like you're trying to get to a point where you can come to an agreement. So I think that it's just like a little bit more. Thank you.
Thank you, Commissioner Freeman. Do I have other commissioners who would like to speak? If not, I'm ready for a motion.
Madam Chairman?
I do, apparently, the applicant would like to speak. The public hearing is closed. Commissioner Freeman.
I would like to hear what the developer might have to say about the comments I made.
Like, I would like to respond to the question, the comments that were made by Dejana in regard to, I've talked with the developer, and I want to say this, we did meet with the neighborhood as we said we would do. It was very educational for us, for them. It was probably one of the most cordial meetings that I've had over 30 years of doing this work. And I think everybody was really trying to work together and to get information and also for get us to understand how they felt and what they were going through with the neighborhood, that they weren't aware that this was going to take place or was attempting to take place. So I thank you all very much for what you have been able to share with us and to help us as we move along. I also just talked with the developer, and we would like to respectfully request one more continuance so that we could try to address some of the issues that you all have raised that you felt was important to you and also that you felt was important to the community. So I respectfully request that at this time. Thank you, especially in regard to the density matter.
Thank you. The chair is going to recognize Commissioner Bryan.
Well, I would be happy to move that we grant the applicant's request for a one-cycle deferral, which in this case will be a little bit more than 30 days since we're a week early this month.
I'll second the motion.
Madam Chairman, before we vote, I would like to know if the neighborhood is how interested they are in an extra cycle on this.
Let me recognize the staff.
Just as a note, if it is a 30-day referral, that's not going to give adequate enough time for them to submit anything to us to review it before it comes before you guys again.
I think the problem we have is that they've already had two cycles, so they only got one left.
This is a bit irregular.
Come to the podium if you're going to speak.
I would just like to ask, as you asked us if we would be okay with deferring this until the next meeting, what the difference is in us deferring it as opposed to if it was voted on tonight and voted against versus being deferred for another month, what that changes in terms of how this issue would get voted on in the future. I apologize, my knowledge of such things is small, but I do think it's just something that would be helpful to know when we choose.
I have a staff response.
Aaron Kane with the Planning Commission. If you get a 1 month deferral, then this case will come again mm-hmm. for a potential vote before the Planning Commission next month. If not, if the Planning Commission decides to vote tonight, that recommendation will move on to City Council, who would hear it at a public hearing for anybody to come speak before them to make their decision in about 2 months.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I have a motion on the floor.
Yeah, move the question.
Okay, I'm ready to call for the vote.
Mr. Alturk?
Sorry, what's the
motion's 30-day, okay. One cycle before.
Yes.
Before we vote on this, did we not just hear that 30 days would not be enough time for staff to do what they have to do? And
may I address, she's going to address it.
Sarah Young with the Planning Department. We just want to advise you that we may not have sufficient time to really delve into the details and provide you with any updated staff report. It may be on the fly at the next meeting. But you don't have any real other choice if you're going to continue it.
Can I ask, but 90 days is the maximum you can continue a case, right?
Correct.
So they only have 30 days remaining.
Right, that's why I said you don't have a lot of choice. Exactly.
So you don't have any choice.
Exactly.
Mr. Alturk?
Yes.
Mr. Bryan?
Yes.
Mr. Busby?
Yes.
Ms. Freeman?
Yes.
Mr. Gibbs?
Yes.
Mr. Harris?
Yes.
Mr. Hornbuckle?
Yes.
Ms. Hyman?
Yes.
Mr. Johnson?
Yes.
Mr. Kinchin?
Yes.
Mr. Miller?
Yes.
Motion carries unanimous, 11-0.
Thank you. I'm going to give the individuals an opportunity to leave before we move to the next case.
Wow.
Take that one. We're ready for the staff report on the next item, which is 108 Celeste Circle, item number Z160006.
Good evening again, Kyle Taylor with the Planning Department. I'll be presenting zoning case Z160006, 108 Celeste Circle 2. The applicant for this case is Dan A. Jewell from Coulter Jewell Thames. It's in the city's jurisdiction. The request is from RS20 to Office Institutional with a Development Plan. The acreage is 0.46 acres. And the proposal is for a service parking lot to serve the office use on the adjacent parcel. Site is located at 108 Celeste Circle, east side of Celeste Circle, and north of NC 54 Highway in the compact neighborhood tier in the MTC I-40 and FJB watershed overlay protection. The site satisfies the requirements for the OI district as highlighted on this slide and in your staff report. The parcel is wooded and developed within occupied single-family residential building and an accessory structure. The proposed project is located within 1/2 mile radius of the future Lee Village Light Rail Transit Station identified in the Triangle Transit Regional Rail Local Preferred Alternative, or LPA. Staff plans to implement the transit-oriented compact neighborhood zoning district within, which encourages a mix of uses and emphasize pedestrian-oriented design in this area in the future. The project meets the requirements for a development plan for the OI zoning district. The proposed conditions page commits to one access point. designates trees for preservations, the parking envelope, and size and location of project boundary buffers. The minimum commitments for this project is one external site access point, which is to the office building to the south. The impervious surface maximum of 70% or 0.322 acres. Location of access points, parking envelope, and location of trees for preservation or all graphic commitments. There are a number of commitments associated with the project, including the fact that the phasing will be constructed in one phase. Driveway access to the property will be limited to the southern corner, the southeast corner of the site, as depicted on sheet DP2. The proposed use shall be a service parking lot. No building shall be constructed. Reservation of 10 feet of property frontage for potential future widening of Celeste Circle by Go Triangle. Stormwater runoff rate will be controlled up to 100-year storm events, and the parking lot entry will be gated to control unauthorized uses on nights and weekends. Two more additional comments is text commitments is the 25 additional 36-inch tall evergreen, 36-foot, sorry. Tall evergreen shrubs beyond what is required by the UDO will be planted in the proposed project boundary buffer adjacent to Celeste Circle. Specimen trees located between the right-of-way and parking envelope and between the parcels to the north and the parking envelope to the south remain as shown on sheet DP2. The only design commitment associated with this project because of the fact that it is committing to a parking lot is that parking lot lighting will be with LED fixtures. This project is located in the design district and therefore is not consistent with the future land use plan. However, the requested OID zoning district is not consistent with the future land use map of the comprehensive plan, which designates the site as design district. However, the requested OID is an allowable use in the zoning district in the compact neighborhood tier per UDO section 4.1.1A. Furthermore, the applicant requested the zoning map change was submitted prior to the adoption of the Leesville Compact Neighborhood Tier in the future land use map designation of design district. Staff is supportive of the application because it is limited to parking lot and parking standards are by tier. The proposal will meet the standards in the UDO for parking lot in the compact neighborhood tier. A building at build out, this project will comply with the same regulations that would apply if it were zoned compact design. Therefore, staff determines that the request is consistent with the intent of the comprehensive plan and previously adopted policies. on this slide, you can see that this plan is consistent with these plans, with the exception of the design district, which I just mentioned previously. And as such, staff determines that this request is consistent with the comprehensive plan and acceptable and applicable policies and ordinances. Thank you, and staff is available for any questions.
Okay, I do have one individual who has signed up to speak, the applicant, Dan Jewell.
Good evening, Madam Chair, fellow commissioners. My name is Dan Jewell. I'm president of Coulter Jewell Thames, landscape architect in private practice. We're landscape architects and civil engineers here in Durham, about a block away. We've been asked by the partners of Central Dermatology to help them with this application and say a few words to you tonight. So I see all the looks on your faces. We're here this evening to present a proposal that you saw first about a year and a half ago in a different form by a different developer and a different design firm. And what you have before you today, although it is still a parking lot, it is a different use of the land in terms of how it impacts the neighborhood, and most importantly, how it does not impact the neighborhood. This parking lot will now solely be for the use of Central Dermatology. The previous proposal was by UNC Medical. They were creating a commercial parking lot for the entire complex over there. There is a demonstrated parking problem. The Central Dermatology folks were the first medical use on that site. They've been there almost 20 years ago. You all remember the old Landlubbers, the old Echo International, when those vacated. Central Dermatology has been there all that time. For the first many years, there was not a parking issue out there. There weren't that many users, and a great majority of the land remained developed only as a parking lot. And then when they built that new UNC Medical Clinic building, and I think you all know is there now with a lot of different outpatient uses, that's when the parking issues began. Because Central Dermatology owns the adjacent property, they are able to make specific design commitments, and which we have done so with the neighbors, that the previous application was not able to do. The folks at Central Dermatology started engaging in regular meetings with the neighborhood, the Eastwood Park neighborhood, which we all sometimes refer to as Celeste Circle, about 9 months ago, after the first proposal by UNC Medical failed, because even though that proposal did not get passed, the parking needs are still there. Their patients have a difficult time finding parking spaces on their own property because it's hard to police where the patients at the other facilities come in. And I've been told that folks sometimes have to circle the parking lot for 10 to 15 minutes to be able to find a parking space. So they started those conversations with the neighbors over various and sundry issues, including parking that had been occurring at some point in the neighborhood. That's been solved. The fact that trash was being picked up in the wee hours in the morning, the neighbors didn't like that, so they promised that won't happen anymore. In June of this year, we had a meeting with the neighbors to discuss this specific proposal. We had submitted our application. We showed the plans. We discussed. We listened. In many cases, the neighbors were having discussions among themselves about what they wanted to see and what they did not want to see. And at the end of the night, we ended up with committed elements and a proposal that we think was much more palatable to the neighborhood. I think you see by lack of an audience here tonight that I believe we've done a good job on that. We did send a follow-up letter to the neighborhood articulating our committed elements on this plans. And so the proposal before you tonight includes things that were not included on the previous proposal, which we do think makes it more palatable, more sensitive to the neighborhood, and does not denigrate the neighborhood in any way. In fact, the fact that we're now going to have parking to serve the staff and the patients of Central Dermatology means that they will not be a burden on the neighborhood. We're controlling stormwater runoff to a 100-year storm. That's unprecedented, but those of you who are familiar with Eastwood Park know that they've had stormwater problems for a long, I think they've had stormwater problems from the day it was developed. So A 100-year storm is unprecedented, but that's a promise we made to the neighbors that we would control to that. The neighbors had some concern that maybe a building, commercial building, would be constructed. We have a committed element that no building will be constructed. It's simply a parking lot. Because Central Dermatology is adjacent, we've committed that the driveway access will only be to the southeast corner of the site, connecting to the existing Central Dermatology parking lot. There will be no driveway onto Celeste Circle. I'll stop for a second. I believe Aaron handed out our one simple little exhibit tonight. It is the development plan with a little bit of color. And I wanted to put that out there because I think it's a very graphic representation of how the proposed parking lot will now be tucked to the southeast, preserving the buffers along the front and to the north. As Kyle mentioned, we're committing to 25 additional 36-inch tall evergreen shrubs along Celeste Circle above and beyond what the ordinance would require from a buffer standpoint. That's a commitment. And we've now committed to preserving some of the major trees along that Celeste Circle frontage as well. And finally, the neighbors also had some concerns that at night, what if somebody drove into the parking lot and they were doing something they shouldn't be doing? We will gate the parking lot, and the last person out with Central Dermatology every night will close and lock up that parking lot, and they will open it up in the morning. I received an email last night from Chris Selby. I think many of you know who Mr. Selby is, at least in the last published neighborhood list on the city website. He at that time was the agent for the Eastwood Park Neighborhood Association. Dan, received your letter about the current plan for 108 Celeste. The plan appears to accommodate the concerns of the neighbors, especially regarding potential stormwater problems. I thank you and your clients. So there is a need for this parking so that we don't end up with additional parking problems in the neighborhood as existed several years ago. Central Dermatology made sure it wasn't their staff and their clients, but they cannot control what happens in the rest of the complex. And again, this parking will be solely for them, and they will control it, and they will continue those conversations with the neighbors. So I appreciate your time. I appreciate your attention to this, and we hope you will agree that beyond the need for the parking, this is a much better application than you saw a year and a half before, and move this forward with a recommendation for approval to the City Council. Thank you.
Thank you. I do not have other individuals to speak. As such, I'm going to close the public hearing and give the commissioners an opportunity to comment. So I will start to my, okay, Mr. Harris. Okay, and Al Turk. Why don't I start with you, Mr. Al Turk, since you raised your hand last.
I just have one question. It was about the Bicycle and Pedestrian Advisory Commission recommended that you had add a text commitment to provide sidewalks, and I was wondering if you had any comment.
Yes, sir. We will certainly be installing a sidewalk along the frontage of the property along Celeste Circle. That's an ordinance requirement, so that's why it's not a text amendment commitment. But in terms of providing bike trails and sidewalks and that sort of thing through the neighborhood, it's frankly beyond the scope of this project to do that. Those of you who've been on the commission for a while know that that's a fairly standard comment that comes out of Mr. McKeel and the bike ped folks. So we will do what we need to do on the frontage of our site. Thank you.
Thank you, Commissioner Harris.
Dan, as a soil and water supervisor, associate supervisor, I'm in favor of the project. I just want to educate myself. How do you plan to satisfy the stormwater needs for the next 100 years? Is it with the buffering system you use?
So my client needs to close her eyes, but close her ears. But it will be with some expense. So it'll be a combination of rain gardens, but we will likely have to go to some underground water storage as well to make it work. The fact that we've committed to that buffer along the front, there's going to be some underground storage on this site to make it work. Yes, sir.
Good. Thank you.
It's physically possible.
Thank you. Commissioner Busby?
Stay right there, Mr. Jewell. All right. Thank you for your presentation. Thank you for going and spending the time with the neighbors and the neighborhood. I think you've answered most of my questions. Mm-hmm. Just to help remind me and others on the commission, the original plan that was brought a year and a half ago, the entrance, was that off of Celeste Circle as opposed to through the...
Yes, sir. It was off Celeste Circle, and in fact, because they were coming off Celeste Circle, I believe they actually had to get a variance from the Board of Adjustment to intrude in the riparian stream buffer, which you, I believe, is still shown on our plan. But that impact has also been eliminated by coming in through the back.
Great. Okay. Second of all, I wanted to just commend you, as Commissioner Harris did as well, on the commitment to control stormwater runoff up to a 100-year storm event. I think that's fantastic, and I hope that's an example that other proposals will take a look at and consider in the future. The final thing, and you answered this question about the gated property, but just to be clear, that was a specific request from the neighbors and the neighborhood?
Yes, sir. They wanted to make sure there was a lot of conversation between lighting or not lighting the parking lot. The parking lot will be lit, but they wanted to make sure that people didn't come hang out at night and do whatever they might do. You use your imagination. So they said a gate would be the best compromise for them, so that's what we've committed to.
Okay. And personally, I'd rather not see a gate there, but if it's in response to the neighbors and what they're asking for, I'm willing to live with it. I think this is a fine proposal, especially seeing that you've worked with the neighbors so carefully, so I plan to support it. Thank you.
Commissioner Miller.
So when I saw this project in our agenda, my reaction was, oh no, not again. I will have to say that it has been very valuable to hear from you, Mr. Jewell, tonight, because I've changed my mind. I note that in the handout that we received from Aaron at the beginning of the meeting on the priority projects, number four here is compact design district zoning for Lee Village. It's something that matters to me a lot. I will say, with regard to Lee Village, my primary concern has been the impact of the Woods Partners project, which I do not like and I think is harmful to the compact neighborhood and design district proposed for the area, but that's over. I lost that one. My second most serious concern about the Lee Village design district is how it will interface with the Celeste Circle neighborhood. And I have to say, of all the scenarios I have crunched through my mind about how that might work, this is actually the best. I like the idea that this actually interacts with property that faces away from the neighborhood, eliminating that Celeste Circle connection and committing to no building here. Is at least for this property, which is part of that interface, is the best result. And I'll vote for this and urge my fellow commission members to join me.
And Commissioner Gibbs.
Just a couple comments, Dan. Tomorrow morning, I'm going to go down this way and make a left-hand turn on the Farrington Road. I'm scheduled for a Remicade infusion. That's a UNC medical center and whatever else medical stuff. They've got all kinds of disciplines of medication, from rheumatology, you name it. That's a lot of dense medical facility, and they ain't got enough parking. Not nearly enough. And I'm going to remember tomorrow when I go in there. This is probably why I had no idea of all the hoops you would have to go through and the expense just to get a parking lot to serve a medical facility or any kind of facility for that matter. And these things are not that impactful to the neighborhood, to anywhere else. It serves them. It serves the that serves the owner. And I guess you can tell I'm venting right now. This kind of thing, well, I'll make a long story short. I am supporting it. It's needed. Anytime you have medical facilities, and I'm sure this must be offers good service, but it does need support, and it serves all of us, so we need to chip in and look the other way, maybe. But at any rate, I am 100% for this, and I've got to say this about bicycles. I don't even know how that came up. If they have reviewed this and wondered if you would provide some bicycle lanes. And I meant to mention this in a previous issue tonight. If we're going to have a bicycle lane in along a highway, I think there should be a visible concrete barrier between bicycle lanes and traffic for their protection and mine, because I'm the one that's going to be taking evasive action. But anyway, that's enough of my complaining. I do support this, and I appreciate the opportunity to vent a little bit. Thank you.
Thank you, Commissioner Gibbs. I think we're ready for the question.
Madam Chair, if I may, I'd like to make a motion that we send case...
Can I just clarify that I think the BPAC recommendation was to add sidewalks and not bicycle lanes, so it's just so that's not totally unreasonable. Yeah.
That was a clarification. So I think we're ready for the question.
Great. I would move that we send case number Z16-0006 forward to the City Council with a favorable recommendation.
Second.
Motion by Commissioner Busby that we move case number Z160006 forward with a favorable recommendation. Second by Commissioner Brine. All in favor of this motion, let's let it be known by raising your right hand. Okay, me too. All opposed? All right. Motion carries.
Motion carries unanimously 11 to 0.
Thank you. Thank you. All right. Let's move to our next item on the agenda. Thank you. New business planning department work program and budget request for FY18 staff.
Thank you. Aaron Kane with the Planning Department. I'll be very brief. You have the cover memo in front of you about this item. I also handed out before the meeting started, just for your perusal and for you to give us input, what we as staff has identified as about 15 to 20 medium to high priority items that we'd like to work on next fiscal year. Believe it or not, for the fiscal year 17-18, we are already starting the budget process, and as part of that, the annual work program that you all usually see in the spring. But we wanted to bring that to you here in the fall to get some input from you at this time, and you can either do that tonight, you can send me an email over the next couple of weeks, however you want to do that, on your thoughts on higher priority items for us to take forward, either something on this list that you find to be of particular priority, or something that's not on this list that you'd like us to consider going forward. Just a reminder, we are getting input from you, but we're also going to our other advisory boards that we staff, such as the Environmental Affairs Board, Durham Open Space and Trails, the Appearance Commission, and so forth. You'll see this again once it's gone through Joint City-County Planning Committee, either in January or February. It'll come back to you in the spring again for a vote and recommendation to the governing boards. But at this time, we're just looking for some input.
Madam Chairman, having just received this and not really having a chance to kind of think about it and weigh it out, I was wondering whether or not we might hold our discussion of this until a place reserved on the agenda for it in our December meeting.
That's fine by us. That's certainly not going to be too late for us to take your input and use it.
Do I need a motion?
Whoever do the agenda, make sure it's an agenda item.
Okay, then we'll include that as an agenda item in December.
Okay, sounds good.
Commissioner Bryan?
I don't want to go against the wishes of the commission, but I had one minor item that I would like to put forward.
Sure.
I want to get back to the question of notification distances, 600 feet for rezoning, 1,000 feet for comp plan amendments, which might could be fit in under miscellaneous revisions to the UDO. My reason for bringing it up, I have recently been to two neighborhood meetings. I got the invitation because I'm 900 feet away from the property, so I'm within the plan amendment thing, but I'm not inside the zoning thing. At these meetings, and both invitations were to discuss a rezoning and a plan amendment, all the discussion has been on the rezonings. I don't think a word was said about a plan amendment in either case. But what we're doing is that we're getting, you know, people are beginning to believe that the distance is the same for each. And I think that that's part of the problem we sometimes run into when we have a rezoning but no plan amendment, but people come in and say, well, I didn't get the notice. And they don't understand this difference between 600 and 1,000. So I would ask that staff take a look at that. Thank you.
Absolutely.
Okay, so that will be another item that we'll include. Thank you.
Thank you.
Item I have is the training budget.
The people who's been on here a while, a couple of years ago, we submitted a resolution to the city and also the county commissioners about including the $2,000 in each one of their budgets to train the commissioners. School of Government offers about three different classes that we can educate ourselves on what we're to do here. And I think some of us have attended some of those classes, but the key is, I think some of them is $300 and some is $400, and they get to be quite expensive, and that was the purpose for including that in the budget. I know I spoke to both city and county managers last year to include it in the budget, and they both appeared to say that, you know, that's not a problem, you know, that's pennies in their budget. Now, whether they did it or not, I don't know. Ms. Smith?
Ms. Smith is not here tonight.
Ms. Grace.
Sarah Young with the Planning Department.
Hi, Sarah.
Just in case you forgot. So although you requested 4,000 in total, what we have in the budget for each commission is $1,000. So just to give you a sense, right, so we have multiple boards and commissions that we, right, so, you know, Board of Adjustment's gonna get $1,000,
okay,
you
okay.
all get $1,000. There was not any specific allocation made, nor did we get additional funds, so this is money that we are eating out of our own operational budget to fund your training. To put it in perspective, when we do commission-wide training, you know, we brought in folks from School of Government, we did that for several of our boards, half a day training from them is $500. So if we continue, this is just food for thought for you all to digest. If we continue to do an annual commission-wide training that touches all of you, that's half of your training money gone. Aaron, I think, sent you an email about some relatively inexpensive a book resource. That would be another way, relatively inexpensively, to get some additional training, kind of self-directed training in your hands. You could also look at prioritizing one or two members to take a School of Government course. That might be, if you chose two, that might be at the expense of doing some other things, because again, we do have a very
limited budget. So I just wanted to put that out there. We're willing to work with you all, but we do have kind of a tight constraint.
Does the staff object if we ask to include in the planning department's budget extra money for training the planning commission? And I have no disrespect for the other agencies, some of which are also planning agencies. I think the Board of Adjustment and probably the Historic Preservation Commission would benefit from the training too. It would be different courses, but I still think that they would benefit. It seems to me that these agencies have a lot of public interaction. And in that interaction is formed a major component of the public's impression and trust in their government. We're kind of that bridge. And I think it's a poor economy to starve these agencies that have this maximum public exposure from training that is not, I mean, at least physically, it's easy to get. It's just a few miles away. It is expensive, but I think the money value is there. I've taken the courses. I think they're great. I wish everybody could. I would like to have us ask the administration to ask for the agencies that have a high public interaction more funding. Especially when that funding can be applied towards such a valuable educational tool.
Commissioner Busby.
Great, thank you, Madam Chair. And Ms. Young, thank you for the update. It was helpful clarification. I know from my personal perspective, I found the day-long, half-day event that we did together, I thought it was very helpful. I think it's something that would be useful to consider doing again, especially since we have a lot of new commissioners who didn't have that opportunity. So it does sound like we have additional funds. What would be useful, and it doesn't have to be answered tonight, but I think I know some commissioners are interested in pursuing those training opportunities. I believe one actually requested the support and was told it wasn't available. So it would be good to get just information on how we as commissioners, what's the right path to move forward to make sure that that a request, if the resources are there, provides that opportunity.
So here's what I would say, two things. One, for the existing resources, the bucket of money that we have available now, what we would look for is you all's recommendation on how you would like to see that. Is your priority to send, you know, a couple of people to the course and call it good for the year and wait till next year? Would you rather do another you know, commission-wide training, plus send one person? It kind of, what priority do you want to establish for the existing funds we have? So we would look for that from you. Moving forward, again, like in years past, you should make a budget request from the chair in writing to the department that we then pass on to the administration through our normal budget process.
Thank you.
If I may, Madam Chair. So the courses that we've been talking about, at least as they relate to this agency, are in the fall. And so for this budget cycle, for the money that's currently in the basket, it's not available for those. And with regard to making a recommendation to staff for spending that, I like the idea that there are books available, and we also may, and there's still plenty of time to bring someone over, like Mr. Lovelady or Mr. Owen, for another training session. I found that to be very useful. And I don't know how much money's in the basket. Is it still $1,000?
It's $1,000.
So if it's $500 for the one and a few bucks for the books, yep. That might be a useful way to use the money up before the end of the fiscal year, which is June 30. But the budget process heats up, if as I recall, right about now. You guys are putting together your request, which then works its tortuous way up through administration. And comes out something completely different, and then goes to the City Council and the Board of County Commissioners. It seems to me if we want to be part of that, maybe we need to think about how we, because it seems to me if you ask for money, you should also outline how you think you're going to spend it, rather than just ask for more money. I think that as useful as it is to have someone come over and spend a few hours with us from the School of Government, it's no substitute for the actual introduction to zoning, introduction to planning and zoning courses and the zoning course, those two courses, since it's so much of what we do. I would like I like the idea of, in addition to whatever else we may do with $1,000 with books and having somebody come in over and talk to us particularly, is to raise enough money to send a couple of us to take the courses in the fall if they want to do that. And I don't want to formulate a proposal right now, but maybe in December I will have a more specific proposal that with some numbers on it that we can play with.
Yes, Commissioner Harris.
I see two things, and in order for us to move forward, I would move or recommend that we recommend to the staff that we do the half-day class, and we do get books for everyone with the current budget, and I'll move that.
I second the motion.
Motion by Commissioner Harris and second by Commissioner Miller that we move forward with the training session for a half day and to order books for all of the commissioners. Adjustment?
No, go on. I have another.
Okay. All in favor of this motion, let it be, just raise your right hand. All opposed? Okay.
Yeah. I have a comment.
The
too.
Second.
Commissioner Harris again.
Second item I have. With the budgetary cycle this time, they have a new vehicle where they're trying to gather more input from the neighbors or from the citizens, and it's going to be computer-based. So when that's rolled out, each of us need to get on there and advocate for ourselves, advocate for the commissioners to receive training monies along with the request coming from the chair. But do you know about the new vehicle that they're using this time?
No, I actually haven't heard of it.
Okay, but they mentioned that, was it INC me?
It was, but I don't think they're actually talking about it this cycle.
Okay, well, we'll find out. But they did introduce a new vehicle for budget to involve more of the residents.
The chair recognizes Commissioner Al Turk.
Thank you, Chairwoman. Can I just ask a clarifying question? I think you said, Sarah, that each commission gets $1,000. Is that for training, or maybe I misheard you?
We have the planning department out of our own budget have set aside $1,000 for each board that we staff.
So is it possible that it's a bigger pool that all commissioners and all committee members just draw from rather than having $1,000 for each commission and board, or would that be? I think following up on Commissioner Miller's suggestion that, you know, maybe some commissions need it more than others, but I'm being selfish here, so I'm sorry.
I understand. We also have the, as Commissioner Miller mentioned, the Historic Preservation Commission and the Board of Adjustment, which are quasi-judicial boards, and also need fairly regular training to keep up on procedure and acclimate new members as they come. So we tend to think of these three boards, you all and those two, as kind of on the same playing field in terms of training needs. At least that's staff's perspective.
Madam Chair, it's down here.
Commissioner Gibbs.
I do have a question. I'm just full of questions tonight, aren't I? As a schedule for these things, we don't necessarily have to have this training every year for everybody. I would think once you've had it, you don't need to go back. It may be a cycle of 2 or 3 years for newer board members. That's another issue with that. It might help in budgeting, and maybe we can even let it accumulate. Anyway, it was just a thought that I had. What happened down there?
I said, budgets are use or lose. You leave some money in the pot.
I know. There was something else that I was going to mention, but it evidently wasn't that important. But anyway, I just thought I would throw that in as a consideration. I do like the idea of the in-house training, too. and a book. This book that you you sent out looks pretty doggone interesting and full of good, useful information. Thanks. Thank you, ma'am.
I think we have spent our $1,000 for this cycle. So, do we have other announcements?
Next month, I believe we have two cases, the one continued from tonight, another case, and then the repeat item to discuss work program and further, if you want to talk about budget as well.
What's the new zoning case?
It's called the Village Hearth Co-Housing Project. It's a PDR 2.1, the Infinity Road Project, yes. That's ready to come to you next month.
Any other announcements? Motion to adjourn.